In an earlier calculus course, you may have seen so-called trigonometric substitutions. This is a technique to compute integrals when quotients of sines and cosines are involved, and they are quite messy. Fortunately, this type of integrals can be done much easier and faster using complex variables. How? You will learn that in this video. And as an example, we'll use the integral of 1 over a plus b times sine theta, so with parameters a and b. So actually already quite a difficult one. A and b have to be positive, we require that. Furthermore, we want a to be bigger than b, because if we take a bigger than b, we are sure that a plus b times sine theta is never zero. So the function is nice and positive everywhere, so we expect in the end to end up with some positive number. So how are we going to do that? Well, we'll use complex variables and we'll define z equals e to the power I theta. Because theta is going between 0 and 2 pi over there, that means that the variable z is going once around the unit circle. So we'll get a contour at the unit circle, circle of radius 1, and we go around once counterclockwise. So how are we going to compute integrals of this type? What you always do, you have to get rid of the d theta first. That will always work the same way. We know that dz equals I times e to the power I theta d theta. And then we want to get rid of the e to the power I theta. It's just no problem because it happens to be equal to z. So we get an I times z times d theta. So d theta equals dz over iz. That's always the same. Then we have to get rid of sine theta. Well, sine theta equals e to the power I theta minus e to the power minus I theta with a 1 over 2 I, a small typo here. And we have e to the power I theta equals z and e to the power minus I theta equals 1 over z. So that's how we get sine theta. Well, we plug everything in over here into our integral. And then we have now our integral in terms of z. Well, next step would be to clean everything up a bit. So multiply the z here with the a and the z and the 1 over z to clean up some of the mess. And then we are at this part over there. And then we like to have a numerator which a denominator which behaves as z squared plus something. So we like to have a 1 in front of the z squared. Well, that is possible. We have now a b over 2 in front of the z squared. So what can we do? Multiply numerator and denominator by 2 over b. And that way we get a 1 in front of the z squared. So 2 over b times the numerator, we can just take it out. And in the denominator we get our desired z squared. The minus b over 2 times 2 over b yields a minus 1. And the aiz times 2 over b yields a 2aib over z. So now we have an integral of the form 2 over b integral 1 over some polynomial, and we define that polynomial as p of z. Well, it's a second order polynomial, so we know it has two zeros, and let us call those zeros z minus and z plus, like this. Why do we want to do it like this? Well, we have to know where those zeros are. Later on, we want to apply the theorem of residues, and only zeros of the denominator will contribute to our integral. If the zeros are outside the unit circle, they do not contribute, and if they are inside the unit circle, they will give some contribution to our integral. So we have to figure out where z minus and z plus are. So first we have to know what they are in terms of a and b. Well, okay, we can complete the squares for our p of z. So our z squared plus 2aib over z, that will be a z plus ai over b between brackets squared. Then we have a factor ai over b squared too much, so we have to subtract that. And we also had the minus 1 over here. So we keep the minus 1. And then we can solve for the z plus ai over b, bring the constants to the right-hand side, so we get a 1 minus a squared over b squared to the right-hand side. And now it's good to step back and to think a bit about the sine of the right-hand side first. We know that our a is bigger than b, so a over b is bigger than 1, so a squared over b squared is a number bigger than 1. So 1 minus a squared over b squared will be negative. So we take out the minus sign, so we get a minus something positive. So we have a square equals minus something positive, so that means the square will be plus or minus I times the square root. And so we have our two solutions here, z plus equals something plus I times the square root, and z minus equals something minus I times the square root. But we still don't see whether these two are inside or outside our unit circle. So we have to go on. We take a look at z minus first. We see z minus equals an I times something, or minus I times something. That means that the norm of z minus equals the norm of minus I times the norm of the something. Well, the norm of minus I is just 1, so the norm of z minus is just the norm of the a over b plus the square root. And we can show, in fact, that this quantity is bigger than 1, so that z minus will be outside the unit circle. How can we see that? Well, this square root result is positive, so the norm of a over b plus the square root will be bigger than just the norm of a over b. So over here, and then the same argument, a is bigger than b, so a over b is bigger than 1, and there we go. Norm of z minus is bigger than 1, so z minus is outside the unit circle, somewhere over there. And then what about z plus? Well, if z plus were outside the unit circle, our function is analytic, and the integral would be 0. Well, that cannot be the case. We know already that the answer has to be positive, so it's probably this z plus will be inside the unit circle. Well, we can easily see that if we look at the p of z. If we look at the constant term, so the constant term equals the minus z plus times minus z minus, so z plus z times z minus, and it's the constant term of the polynomial over here, so that equals minus 1. So that we know that the norm of z plus times z minus equals 1, so that means that the norm of z plus equals 1 over the norm of z minus. Norm of z minus is bigger than 1, so the norm of z plus is smaller than 1, so that one is somewhere inside the unit circle. So, let's summarize a bit. We had our integral, we have rewritten it in terms of 2 over b times integral 1 over z minus z plus z minus z minus. We know the z plus where they are, the z plus is inside, and the z minus is outside the unit circle. So we can apply the theorem of residues. The integral equals 2 pi I times the residue of f in z plus. Well, that residue is easy to compute. Multiply by z minus z plus and plug in z equals z plus. That gives us this term over here. So there we have our integral. But how can you see whether it's real? It looks complex, and it should be a real number. It's just a real integral in the end. Well, just plug in what z plus and z minus are. Z plus was minus I over b plus a square root, and z minus was minus I over b minus square root. So what happens if we take the difference of z plus minus z minus? Then we see the minus I a over b cancel out, and we end up with 2 times our square root times I. So there we are. Plug this in over there. And simplify a bit. You see that the I's cancel out, and you end up with some real number. So there we have our integral, 2 pi over square root of a squared minus b squared. And notice, by the way, that this is a positive number because a was bigger than b. And this is how it should be, because we have a positive function which we were integrating. So this was a rather hard example due to the parameters a and b. So if you have some explicit numbers, using this technique will be, well, relatively quite a lot easier.